Chapter 22 of Grace Harlowe's Overland Riders on the Old Apache Trail by Jessie Graham Flower. Chapter 22, Relics of an Ancient Race. The Gordons and Cartwrights had engaged a conveyance to take them to the point on the Apache Trail where they must turn off and walk about a mile to reach the homes of the cliff dwellers. The Overland Riders preferred to ride their ponies, Ike taking his team to carry himself and the rations for the day. Tucked away with the equipment was a strong rope several hundred feet in length, Ike, at Grace's request, having provided this and other equipment without asking too many questions. An early start was made, both parties reaching the turning-off place at about the same time, and shortly thereafter a merry company, carrying picnic baskets, was ascending the steep, narrow trail that led to the Tonto cliff dwellings. They found the first of the two main groups of prehistoric community dwellings free of tourists, and the Overton College girls stood in awe as they gazed on the massive masonry of this relic of an unknown past. "Are you familiar with the history of these cliff dwellings, Mrs. Gray?" asked the General. "I must confess that I am not wholly familiar with the subject, sir. Will you tell us what you know about them?" "No one knows of their beginning, nor of the people who inhabited them. We do know that Coronado's scouts discovered them nearly 400 years ago. The Coronado scout, it is said, believed that they found the frontier fortresses of that rich kingdom of Tontontiac, which was one of the seven they sought." "The dwellings were not then occupied, were they?" asked Anne. "Oh no," responded the General. "They were in ruins as you see them now, so you can form some idea of the antiquity of the dwellings." "Do you know whether or not the cliff dwellers were here ahead of the Indians, sir?" said Grace. "It is supposed that they were, for the Indians of the present day do not even know of them in legend. The dwellers must have had enemies, man or beast, for you see they built their castles in out-of-reach spots. They builded them well, too, high underleaning walls of rock, of blocked stone, set with strong adobe mortar. They were architects, and they were builders, were those ancients," declared the General. "A peculiar feature of their homes is that each community lived in a community house, said to have included 60 to 70 rooms. The three dwellings that are accessible do not show what the inner arrangements were, but a fourth one, that has never been explored, is believed to be in a better state of preservation. That is the one I propose to have a look at," declared Grace. "I suspected as much," nodded the General. "Don't try it, is my advice. You don't know what kind of a precipice one would have to pass over to get there." "I know the precipice, for I have examined it through my glasses. But I am not convinced that there is no other entrance to that place." "What makes you think that?" "The formation of the sheer wall that falls away from their front dooryard shows that it has been in that same condition for perhaps thousands of years, and probably was in the same condition in the days of the cliff dwellers. Suppose we have our luncheon here, and then we have a look at the top of this unknown cliff home." All through the luncheon that was eaten in an ancient community house with the magnificent view of mountains and canyons spread out before them, General Gordon was regarding Grace perplexedly. "I believe she really intends to try it," he muttered. "How, I do not know. She does, though, and I have no doubt the plan is already clearly outlined under that head of fair brown hair." "So you do not believe I can do it, eh?" chided Grace, favouring the officer with a brilliant smile. "Do not believe... Mrs. Gray, are you a mind reader?" demanded the General. "When a mental process is reflected in a face, as it has been in yours for the last 5 minutes, the reading is easy." The General shrugged his shoulders in true French form. "I give up," he exclaimed. I wish the walls of this ancient place might be read as easily," added Grace. "Do you think the ladies can stand to climb to the top of the mountain?"
"Oh, yes, it is not a long nor a very hard climb, I should judge from the looks of it," replied the general.
It was decided to leave the hampers at the lunching place, but to carry their mess kits. Grace told Ike Fairweather to take the rope with him as it might be needed. In her own kit she carried a ball of stout twine, ammunition for her rifle, and for the automatic that swung in its holster. "All is ready. Please take your time, ladies, and if you tire, you must say so," she directed. "We follow where you lead, Mrs. Gray," promised Miss Cartwright dramatically.
"Don't make rash promises, Miss Cartwright," warned the general. "You don't know what you are promising."
"I think I do."
"Just wait and see," teased the young woman. It was a hard hike to the brow of the mountain, taking nearly 2 hours at the rate they travelled. The party finally came out on a broad table of rock, from which the mountain sloped away a short distance, then took a sheer drop of 1,000 feet. None of the party ventured to look over the brink until Grace finally did so, then turned laughingly to Miss Cartwright.
"Are you following?"
"Yes." Miss Cartwright stepped up beside Grace and gazed off over the great precipice. Suddenly the army officer's sister swayed dizzily, and had Grace lost her head for a second, a disaster probably would have resulted. Grace's arm quickly encircled the waist of Miss Cartwright and drew her back, now in a fainting condition. The dizzy height had been too much for the young woman's nerves. Grace gravely handed her over to Colonel Cartwright.
"I am sorry, sir, that I encouraged her. It was not prudent of me at all," she said.
Grace, after studying the face of the cliff for a few moments, stepped back and spoke to Ike Fairweather, pointing to a projecting tower of rock that crowned the tableland like a monument.
"You can snub the rope around that," she said.
"Mrs. Gray, surely you are not going to try that desperate descent," begged General Gordon.
"Try is the word, General. If you think it advisable, take Mrs. Gordon and Miss Cartwright for a walk. To see me go over may upset them. The descent is perfectly safe, provided the rope doesn't break. I have my reasons, other than mere curiosity, for attempting to get to the community house down there."
"Very good, Mrs. Gray. Depend upon me for whatever I may be able to do."
"I think I understand your real motive. Do not worry about the ladies. If they cannot stand it to see you go over, they can turn their backs on you."
Preparations were quickly made, Miss Cartwright observing wide-eyed and a little pale. Ike had made a sling with a board bottom for Grace to sit in. In addition to this, she slipped a loop of rope under her shoulders. Grace then produced the ball of strong twine from her kit and made an end fast to the monument. She directed that someone keep hold of the twine at all times for signals.
"One pull will mean that I have a message to send up. 2 pulls will advise you that I am to be hauled up," Grace informed them.
"Are you ready?"
"Ready," announced the 4 men in chorus.
General Gordon added that he would stand at the upper edge of the slope and watch Grace over its lower edge, from which point she would have a sheer drop of what he estimated to be about 300 feet to the cliff dwelling.
"Loyalheart, do be careful," admonished Elfrida anxiously. "I know there is no use trying to dissuade you from attempting this foolish thing, so we can do nothing except to wish you luck."
"Yes, you can. You can hold fast to the rope," corrected Grace. Smiling and nodding to her companions, she took a final look about, then crept cautiously down to the edge of the slope, where the sheer drop began, waved a hand, and disappeared over the edge of the precipice.
End of chapter 22.